Quite enjoying the championship so far, and at the time of recording this video, which is 2:30 on Saturday, Oxford are in the playoffs. Hello everybody and welcome back to OUFC Fan View. It's Ian here once again and it's time for another review of another Oxford United game. Today, Oxford were at home again, this time to Stoke City. The international break always seems to suck the life out of the Football League calendar, so it was great to be back in league action today. Seems like a lifetime ago that we beat Preston in the last home game. Also seems like a lifetime ago the last time we played Stoke City in a league game, which again, just highlights the calibre of opposition in the championship. This one was not pretty. It wasn't a great game, certainly in the first half. It did pick up in the second half, but nobody's going to care about that because all that matters is Oxford United got the victory. Oxford make it 3 wins from 3 home games. It finished. Oxford United won. Stoke City nil. It felt like a 1-0 kind of a game, and that really could have gone to either side, but it's great that Oxford United got that victory. But we'll break down everything. I'll go over the team news, I'll give my review of the game, and I'll give my final thoughts for both sides at the end of the video. I do put timestamps down below, so if you do just want to jump to the end or any point of the video, then that's absolutely fine. But if you do, the very least you can do is hit that like button, because that does help me out a heck of a lot. And if you do generally like the content on the channel, and if you do like the new predictions videos that I'm going to be doing as well, then please subscribe. So let's go into the team news then, and starting with the home side in Oxford United. And Des Buckingham makes 4 changes to the side that beat Preston North End a couple of weeks ago. The big news is skipper Elliot Moore returns to the heart of the defence, and that is always a welcome and reassuring sight. Greg Lees in left back, Idris El Mizouni starts in midfield, and Oxford's record signing, Sarike Dembele, gets a home start for the first time on the left wing. The players removed from the side are Matt Phillips due to injury, Joe Bennett with an even longer injury, and I don't think you're going to see him for a while. We miss you, Joe. Hope you get back soon. Sam Long and Rueben Rodrigues are the other players relegated to the bench. Josh McEachran once again keeps his place in the holding role in midfield, which we'll talk about at the end, because again, it does raise some question marks and eyebrows. And the August player of the month, Mark Harris, is leading the line, looking to be a record breaker and score for a 5th consecutive championship game. Let's move on to the visitors, and Steven Schumacher's Potters are level on points with Oxford going into this game, and they also make 4 changes from a side that won 1-0 away at Plymouth. Gibson, Sidibe, Gooch and Cannon are the guys coming in, and they replace Phillips, Moran, Kumas and Memmi. Stoke fans will no doubt be happy to see Ben Gibson back in defence for them. Million Manhoff, he scored the winner in the game against Plymouth, and he starts up front in a 3-man front line alongside new signing Tom Cannon. It's only 3 goals so far in the league for Stoke in the 4 games, so they'll be hoping that Cannon can remedy that, and he's the answer to their prayers in front of goal. Another new signing for Stoke is Tatsuki Seko, and he also starts on the bench. Moving on to the game then, and it's one of those games where I could talk about the team news for far longer than the first half, because this was a very scrappy and poor quality half of football. 8 minutes on the clock was the first sign of life, really, and it was Oxford who had that sign of life with Dembele winning a ball on the left-hand side and galloping clear into the penalty area. He got to the pivotal moment where he had to decide whether to shoot or cross, and he lost his footing and just fell over. 3 minutes later, Mark Harris chanced his arm, or chanced his foot, from range. It was from long, long range. It was a snapshot, and it was easy for the Stoke keeper, Johansson. On about 16 minutes, Stoke had a decent couple of minutes of play, and they were getting some joy down the flanks, and it was Stoke's turn to have a pot shot from range. It was one of the few shots in the game that Stoke actually had. It was Ben Wilmot, the defender, who had it, and he was miles out, but it was a good strike. But it was easy for Jamie Cumming. And this game just drifted along, really, with not much happening. No real fault to either sets of fans. They were giving it a go. Certainly the Stoke fans were in good voice. Seemingly out of nothing on 30 minutes, that was the next real moment of life in this game. And it was just a mistake at the back, and Oxford won the ball back. And it presented Goodrum with half a yard, half a chance to get a shot away on the edge of the box. He is quite far out, actually. It's probably more like 25 yards out. Again, a decent strike, but pretty easy for Johansson to just beat it away. I seem to be highlighting Oxford's fleeting moments in the first half, but Stoke had some moments of joy as well, and certainly down the flanks they did look dangerous. Lyndon Gooch actually went off injured and he was replaced by Moran, and within minutes of coming on he got into a dangerous area and it was presented a shooting chance on the edge of the box which Oxford did well to block. 38 minutes on the clock, and for the second time in the half, it's Dembele who woke the crowd up by winning a ball in the Stoke half and galloping down the left-hand side. He got into the area, and once again, when he got to the pivotal point, he just made a bit of a bad decision. His cross kind of bisected Harris and Goodrum, and it was a little bit of a wasteful chance that went begging. And then probably the biggest talking point for Oxford in the first half was Branigan went off injured. He went into a 50-50 ball and came off worse from that 50-50. I'm not sure whether he jarred his knee or did something worse. It remains to be seen. He did walk off the pitch, which is normally a good sign, but he didn't come back on, and he was replaced by Rueben Rodrigues right at the end of the first half. The first half did actually end with Stoke on top. Few corners, few throw-ins into the box. The first corner actually nearly caught Jamie coming out, nearly went directly in. He had to pour it away at the near post. But we got to half-time at 0-0, and I think both sets of fans were just quite happy to walk away, have a cup of tea and come back for the second half, because both sides really cancelled each other out. It became very compact in the midfield, and both sides really struggled in possession. There were a lot of mistakes, a lot of sloppy passes, and neither side could really create any sustained pressure. There were a few fleeting, flickering moments of quality, but not much. And hopefully, we'll get a better second half. We couldn't have got a worse second half than the first half, and we certainly did get a better standard in the second half. And it was actually Stoke who started the better side within the first 2 minutes, maybe the best move they put together in the whole game, passing it slickly from back to front, one-touch passing, much higher tempo than what we'd seen in the first half. Got down the Stoke left, Oxford right, nice cutback on the byline, and it got Manhoff in space. And it's lucky for Oxford, he just could not pick out a teammate as he tried to side foot roll a pass into the middle of the goal. Just luckily for Oxford, it just avoided everybody, and harmlessly we could clear the danger. And that kind of woke Oxford up, really, because 2 minutes later, we got the goal. We got the goal that won the game. It seemed to spur Oxford into life. It was Idris El Mizouni with his first goal for Oxford United. And very similar to the chance that Stoke just spurned. And it was Rodrigues who did excellently well in the build-up to this goal. He got some space on the right-hand side, got into the penalty area. And unlike Manhoff, who couldn't pick out a teammate for Stoke, Rodrigues was able to pick out a teammate with his rolled pass across goal, and El Mizouni arrived on it perfectly, and it was a calm finish from 8 yards. Oxford had the bit between their teeth now, and they had the momentum, and they were pushing for the second, and it seemed like Oxford were getting so much space and time on the ball as Stoke kind of had to weather the pressure. A wicked cross from Greg Lee on 56 minutes, just out of the reach of Mark Harris. But a few minutes later, a fine ball over the top, and Sparky's running in on goal. He's not clean through, and there's a couple of defenders around him. Gets to about the edge of the box, and it's a good strike from Mark Harris, and again Johnson does well to clear the ball away. Just a massive improvement from both sides, but Oxford were looking good in this second half. Dembele and Lee were linking up very well down the left-hand side. Wonderful interchange of passing on 60 minutes, actually, from the other side, the other flank. It was Peter Kioso threaded a delightful pass through to the on-rushing Rueben Rodrigues. He got there just ahead of the keeper on the slide, but Stoke were able to bundle the ball behind for a corner. And it felt like Oxford were going to get that second goal, because, as I said, we were in the ascendancy, and the midfielders were just getting so much space with all the second balls that were coming their way. But Stoke did get back into this game, and on about 70 minutes they did start to create more chances, well, not really chances, but get into dangerous areas. They were so wasteful in the final third, and that is going to be the number one thing where Steven Schumacher and the Stoke fans come away from this game frustrated with. But as I said, yeah, they were starting to cause Oxford some problems. They were at the midfield, were starting to get more space, and they were getting some to some dangerous areas down the flanks, but they just could not get a shot away. away. They could not work Jamie coming, but Stoke were pressing, and it meant Oxford were relying more on the counter-attack. But on 78 minutes, Oxford nearly did get that second goal on the break. It came from a good ball in from Stoke, actually, which Elliot Moore had to head away from a dangerous area inside the six-yard box. But then Dembele got the ball, and he was able to stretch his legs, and he got Oxford up the pitch. He gets the ball into Harris. Harris to Goodrum, on about the edge of the box. Goodrum drives it towards goal, and it's once again Johansson making a good save to put it behind. From that shot, that created a corner and created some pressure, and Oxford had a huge chance to win it a minute later. That should have been game over, really. Corner in from the right-hand side. Glancing header falls to Peter Kioso. He is 3 yards out. Open goal, and he blazes it over the bar. It is a bit of a shocking miss, really, and it would have been game over, and thankfully it didn't come back to haunt United. Stoke continued to push and press, but it was Oxford who were having the better chances. 84 minutes, chance for Aboué, who came on as a sub. He had a couple of efforts on goal. His second shot was better than the first, but again, Johansson was the wall in goal that Oxford couldn't breach. Only but the one time. Got to give credit to Aboué and Goodrum, actually, as it was their tenacity late on in the game, 84th, 85th minute, which led to a Stoke mistake at the back. It's great to see Oxford continuing to put the pressure on and not just drop back and defend. Barring one good cross into the area, which just evaded Stoke's players and Jamie Cumming was able to hold, Oxford saw this game out reasonably comfortably. And it's Oxford who get another win in this championship season, up to 9 points. 3 wins out of 3 from home, a clean sheet, happy days. Let's move on to the final thoughts. And let's start with Stoke City. And I don't think Stoke were great in this game. I think Stoke fans, you can be honest and say that your side wasn't, certainly in the first half, very sloppy, as both sides were. But there were some bright sparks to be hopeful for in terms of, like, I thought that generally at the back you looked pretty solid, and you've got some definitely creative wide players that look like they can cause some problems. But the biggest worry is just where are the goals going to come from? Look, you can't really give Cannon too much of a hard time. It was his first game. He wasn't really in the game at all. But it's just Stoke was so wasteful in the final third, either with the crosses they put into the box or when they did get into a good area. It's just people picking the wrong decision or making the wrong pass. I did think that the old Dutch guy, Manhoff, I thought he looked very, very lively up front. And I thought that the guy that came on to replace Gooch, Moran, he looked pretty good as well. As did Junho. Definitely got some bright sparks and some bright players. But are you going to get that cutting edge? And Steven Schumacher really needs to find that cutting edge, because it just looked to me like it's a side that looks a little bit bereft of ideas in front of goal, which is strange because you have had those big wins in the cup, but you just don't seem to be able to put that forward into the league. But overall, a solid team, definitely, but not a spectacular team by any stretch of the imagination, or certainly not in this game. I would be fascinated to know your thoughts on this, Stoke fans, because you clearly know more about your club than I do. What needs to change? What players need to come into this side? What formation do you need to play? And is it just a matter of time before these young players that you've got just click and then you sort of burst into life and go on a bit of a run? So I would be fascinated to know, and if you can, leave your comments down below. But overall, good luck for the rest of the season, and let's move on to Oxford United. So the results dictate your mood on things, don't they? And this ended up being a 1-0 win, tight game, which Oxford just about nicked, and so you come away with it just feeling like $1 million. I do think that generally, I think in the second, based on the second half performance, I do think Oxford deserved to win the game. The level of intensity was so much better in the second half. You just saw the way they passed the ball around and just got into more dangerous areas more consistently. Just was encouraging. We really kind of pushed Stoke back, certainly at the start of the second half. Great to see El Mizouni getting a goal. I still think there's so much more to come from him. But if I was just to be a little bit critical, I'm just a bit worried that that's 2 home games in a row now. We've started pretty poorly. We were quite poor at the start against Preston, and we kind of needed a goal out of nothing to kind of get us back into this game. And really, we were quite poor in this first half in this game as well. Quite sluggish with the passing, quite slow to get into our rhythm. And I don't know whether that's just, again, new players still getting used to playing in this Oxford side. But I feel like that's something that just can't go on and be successful. We need to kind of start better in these games. But that, in the end, we won the game. So it does boil down to a minor nitpick. And really, Oxford weren't really tested too much in this game. I will say at defence, I thought we looked pretty good. And I thought Greg Lee and Peter Kioso were superb at fullback. Both of them up against tricky wingers. I thought both of them were excellent, particularly Peter Kioso, who I was critical of a couple of games ago in the cup game against Coventry. But the last two games, he has been excellent. Siriki Dembele, you want him to be a Murphy-type player. And yeah, they've talked about him being different, and he certainly is different to Murphs. But he is a player that's going to get people off their feet. He's quick, he's skillful, and you can already see the Oxford fans have got that anticipation whenever he gets the ball. But really, this game did kind of change when Branigan went off injured. And credit for Des Buckingham. He didn't wait for the substitution. He could have waited to halftime, but he brought Rueben Rodrigues on. There were other options. He could have gone with Volks. He could have gone with Sibley. But he chose Rueben Rodrigues, and Rodrigues rewarded that faith showed in him, because he was brilliant in the second half, just snapping into tackles, getting Oxford on the front foot, assist for the goal. But he was at the heart of a lot of the moves that Oxford, where Oxford were looking dangerous. Rodrigues was at the heart of them. And I think overall, Buckingham will be delighted with the 1-0 win. You hear Gary Neville talking about the importance of winning games 1-0 and how it shows that a side is concentrating and isn't just going to give away something sloppy at the end of the game. And I think Buckingham will be excited by that. And I think that he'll be pleased with the way Oxford continued to press and continue to try to win the ball back high off this Stoke side, even late into the game. And again, credit to the gaffer, credit to Buckingham. In Buckingham we trust, because it's he again chose McEachran in midfield. Again, I think McEachran had a good game. Again, you wonder, is that going to be sustainable, or is Volks going to come back into the side? But what a great problem to have, to bring Will Volks into this side when we need him. And if McEachran's going to step up and play this well in the Championship, that's amazing too. I don't think any of us kind of expected that. Also, with Branigan going out injured, it kind of shows you the strength in the squad, because that would have been catastrophic for pretty much all the time that Branigan's been at Oxford. If you lose him, that's like a huge hole in the team. But now that hole doesn't seem so big. Branigan clearly is going to be a loss, but even if he's out for a few weeks, you've still got the cover to come in that isn't going to dramatically weaken the side, and that is very encouraging moving forward. Look, we've got to be delighted with this start. It's better than anybody could have expected, I think. 9 points from the opening five games. We go into Bristol City next weekend, and we all know what that game's going to be like. It's Oxford United old boys, and there's a certain manager in charge who I don't think I'm allowed to name his name, or I might get demonetized by YouTube. He's that much of a dangerous name. You just can't say it. But I'm sure that atmosphere will be excellent. And wouldn't it be amazing to get the first points, or the first point even, on the road away at Bristol City? But we go into this week full of joy, full of anticipation, because Oxford United have won again. Let me know your thoughts, Oxford fans, down below. Let me know what you think, anything can be improved, or how we can even get better than what we've done so far. And Mark Harris didn't score, so he's got to be dropped now, hasn't he? Dropped. Terrible from Harris for not scoring again. But of course, I jest. Yep, leave your comments. That's just about it for me now. I'm sure I've missed some stuff, and you can let me know down below. But also look out for my predictions videos that I'm going to be doing. They're short and sweet, and I always predict Oxford to win. So, you know, that's something. Thanks once again. Enjoy your weekend, and I'll be back very soon.